Your promise is yes and amen. You have done great things. God, you've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, you do great things.
Well, my friends, good morning. What a joy to welcome you into this time. Happy New Year to you as we begin 2024 together. So many things going on inside of our lives. So let me introduce myself. I'm Pastor Scott McCurdy. If you are here for your millionth time, I am so glad you're here. If this is your very first time, it is just a joy. We want to share some announcements with you. If you have not had the chance yet to sign the friendship pad, please do. This is just incredibly valuable to us, and it is so incredibly helpful to what we're doing and how we're doing it. So this week, we are beginning our grand adventure together, and that is the Bible year. We are going to be reading the Bible all the way together. You're going to be hearing a lot more about this in the sermon itself, but here's what I want you to know for right now. We're going to be basing this off the book, The Bible Year. Many of you pre-ordered the book. We, of course, ordered some extras. You do not have to have the book in order to do this. And so one of the other places that you're going to be seeing every week when you come and the path is there, the readings, there is a two-month collection of the readings. So January and February's readings are already in here and ready to go. Or you don't have to use either of those. Go online and find the schedule online with the church. There we go. What else? The clipboard.
The clipboard. I don't have the clipboard. I'm going to go grab the... No, Scott's going to go grab the clipboard while I tell you about it. It's on the donut table.
Oh, it's on the donut table.
We have a wonderful organization within our church called the United Women in Faith. They used to be called the United Methodist Women, UWF. No, UMW. Now they're UWF. Acronyms all over the place. Sorry, we'll get there. They do lots of different events throughout the year. One of the ones that probably everybody in the church is incredibly familiar with is our summer rummage sale. So they're the brains and the hands behind getting all of that organized. With all the events that they do, we always need more hands, more folks willing to help out. And so they have provided us with a clipboard. Ta-da! It has all the events for the entire year that they will be doing and planning and running and hosting and all of this stuff. If you are interested in helping with 1, 2, 5, whatever you might be interested in, please sign up. This is not a hard and fast commitment. If you would like to talk with Judy Linscove, she attends our first service. She would be happy to call you, check in, and answer any questions that you might have about what kind of a commitment this is or not. Some of them are very short time frames. Some of them are a little bit longer if the planning takes time. But we're going to pass this down one side and up the other. Please write your name on there if you are even at all interested in knowing more about a particular event. And like I said, Judy Linscove is the holder of all knowledge. And so if you would like to connect with her, we would be happy to put you in contact with her. Are you short a pen?
No, I have a pen this time. I'm short a list. So.
Oh, the announcement
list.
There
we go. Mm-hmm. And obviously that won't be the last time that you see this. Throughout the year, we'll be letting you know more ways that you can help. I want you to know what went on inside of our mission project for this last month. In December, we were working with the mush tree, that Christmas tree out there, that collected mittens, underwear, socks, and hats. And I want you to know how this turned out. We have lost the list, so we are going to do it by memory. Mittens, we had 38. We had 38 pairs of mittens, and what I want you to know is so powerful with this, is that all of that stuff went out. It went right to the places where it needs to be. Those mittens are being worn on the streets of Rapid City right now. That's how fast they went out. We had underwear. We had 139 pairs of underwear, which, you know, it's one of the only times that you will hear the word church and underwear used in the same sentence, but we're proud of that. Socks, we had 248 pairs.
See, our memory's doing
out there.
Okay.
Yes. And then hats, 46.
Yes.
So it was a wonderful, wonderful, marvelous way to respond. And what you're going to hear more is in the worship today as we get into prayer is this concept of the Scooby-Doo Band-Aid. All right, I have two granddaughters. And one of them is 4 years old, and it is not uncommon at all, of course, for her to come running up to me, Opa, I need a Band-Aid, you know, as if her hand has fallen off. And but what is it that we give? Is it that we give just a Band-Aid? No, it's the love that goes with it. Oh my goodness, girl, let's get that fixed. Let's get that Band-Aid on. Do you need a kiss? Do you need a hug? Yes, Opa. There, now it's fixed. This is what we do. It's not just mittens, underwear, socks, and hats. You're going to be hearing a lot more this morning inside of prayer as we are preparing to be of assistance to Mommy's Closet this week or this month. And this is, it's all the love that goes with it. There we go. That's what I've got.
Did we do Friendship Pad?
We did.
Did we welcome people watching online?
Oh, no. Hey, we wanted you to know this. We're going to be welcoming people online very, very regularly now. In December, the online worship now has become our second largest worship service. And so what we know is that every week we have got all kinds of people that are out there. So those of you who are joining us online, welcome. And remember, if you're not here during the week, if there's a weekend that you can't be here, we have got a wonderful way for you to join us. Yep. There we go. Come on, my friends, let's pray. Gracious God, I want to give you thanks for this day, give you thanks for this new year, and simply ask your blessing. Would you please just be present, fill this time, fill this place as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's stand. Let's sing.
I believe there is no doubt, cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I am his hope, found in your name. I have the strength, found in your grace. Faithfulness, my fortress. are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dragons to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. 'Cause I believe in you, in God I believe in you. Release your love inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over. Oh Lord, make way through the water. Walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring troubles to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, no pain will never fall. Your name is powerful, your words unstoppable. All things are possible in you. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, no pain will never fall. Your name is powerful, your words unstoppable. All things are possible in you. Make way through the water, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dragons to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. I believe in you. I believe in you.
You're the God of the city. You're the king of these people. You're the lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like you, things are yet to come, and greater things are still to come in this city. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done here. You're the Lord of creation, creator of all things. You're the king above all kings. You are. You're the strength in the weakness. You're the love to the broken. You're the joy in the sadness. You are. Greater is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. Things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Where glory shines, your hearts alive, a place for you and love for you in this city. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. But the greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done here. There is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. There is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God.
Today we begin with a unison prayer. And this unison prayer is actually one of the Psalms. It's one of my favorites at the beginning of the year. It's Psalm 29. Here we go.
And we're going to read it together. This is coming from The Message. Join together as we sing, read Psalm 29, taken from The Message. Bravo, God. Bravo. Gods and all angels shout encore in awe before the glory, in awe before God's visible power. Stand at attention. Dress your best to honor God. God thunders across the waters. Brilliant. God's voice and streaming brightness. God across the floodwaters. God's thunder is tympanic. God's thunder is symphonic. God's thunder smashes cedars. God topples the northern cedars. The mountain ranges skip like spring colts. The high ridges jump like wild kid goats. God's thunder spits fire. God thunders and the wilderness quakes. God makes the desert of Kadesh shake. God's thunder sets the oak trees dancing a wild dance. Whirling, the pelting rain strips their branches. We fall to our knees. We call out glory. Above the floodwaters is God's throne, from which God's power flows, from which God rules the world. God makes all people strong. God gives all people peace. Amen and amen. Would you please be seated?
It's time for kids.
This is where children belong. Welcome as part of the worshiping throng. Honor God's word, bread and cup, prayer and song. This is where children belong.
All right, who's feeling strong today? You? Well, I want everybody to feel how heavy it is, though. Oh, what's in there? A computer? Nope.
Oh my gosh.
Library books. There's 66 books in that backpack. Seriously. 66 books in that backpack. And the reason why there are 66 books in that backpack, Taylor, my turn. My personal assistant sometimes takes the show, draws attention away. Okay, so Taylor, come sit down. All right, so there are 66 books in this backpack because in the Bible, there are 66 books. Now, the books that are in the Bible just mean that they're the different kind of sections, and they call them books because they all are kind of different in their own way. So 66 books in here, I'm sure glad that they put them all in one place, because can you imagine carrying that backpack around? Every time you wanted to learn about God or hear God's story, you'd have to carry this around or carry this around. This is much better, isn't it? And that's why if you look at a Bible, the pages are really thin and the words are kind of tiny because they're trying to fit 66 books in there without making it that big and that heavy. Exactly. Do you know that there are two parts to the Bible? There are two parts.
The past and right now.
You're on the right track. He said past and right now. You're on the right track. I think I know what you mean.
Old Testament and the New Testament.
There we go. So the Old Testament meaning before Jesus, and the New Testament meaning Jesus and after. So I see that is what he was talking about, don't you think? Yeah, that you were on the right track. So the grown-ups and the whole church and people who are wanting to, they are going to read the entire Bible this year. Pastor Scott and Stephanie gave us a calendar so that we can take just little tiny bits, and all 365 days we can just read a little bit and get through the whole Bible. That might be a little much for you. Yeah, but if we learn things like there are 66 books in the Bible, there's the Old Testament and the New Testament. All the books are a little different. There are some books that are poetry, and there's letters. Some are kind of history books, and some are books where we learn lessons. Some are realistic fiction? Sure. Absolutely. Well, at least he knows his genres. I'm going with it. So, just thought we would, they're kind of learning their Bible stuff, and we're going to kind of start learning our Bible stuff in that way too. How many books in the Bible? 66. Very good. Okay, let's say a prayer, and then we can go. All right, put your hands together. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the Bible, for giving us those 66 books that we can read and learn from, learn more about you and your message and all the things you want to tell us. But also, don't let that stop us from talking to you, God, from praying and reaching out and being kind to others. Help us as we go through this week. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, you may go back to your spots.
The first scripture reading this morning is from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Here ends the reading.
As we begin prayer today, I want to invite Heather to come. And I want to introduce to you Heather. This month, we are starting a whole new focus on our mission of the month. This is with Mommy's Closet. Heather, tell them who you are and what's going on at Mommy's Closet.
I work for Mommy's Closet, which is Potter Volunteers of America. It is the only diaper bank in Western South Dakota. People are in need because paychecks don't go as far. Or there might be other issues in their life, and they need help with diapers. We provide diapers to moms with children that have special needs. We service over 200 families a month, a lot with multiple children. Women fleeing domestic violence. Single moms working two jobs that's not quite making it. Or everybody knows right now, everything is going up, rent's going up, food's going up, and sometimes the money doesn't stretch far enough to buy diapers or cover the whole diapers. Studies show that one in two families experience diaper need. If a child with special needs, autism, or cerebral palsy, or another condition, sometimes they wear diapers a lot longer. Medicaid doesn't pay for medical diapers until the child is 8 years old. So there is a big gap within the community. Food stamps and WIC do not purchase diapers. It's the love and donations and caring within the community that helps care for these families. At Christmas time, I worked with Black Hills Toy Drive, and 237 children received the wish of having diapers for Christmas. So your participation with this mission project will provide love for these children. If you can't afford a pack of diapers yourself because it's hard, maybe a jar of baby food. So anything and everything helps improve the lives of these children. I just want to thank your church for offering and helping with this mission project to provide diapers for children.
Even the smallest gifts help. One of the most powerful moments that I ever had, Heather, thank you very, very much. One of the most powerful moments that I had in ministry was when one of my seven-year-olds came up to me and said, I want to help. How can I do it? And it was just an amazing thing. Someday I'll tell you the story of what she figured out and how she did it. But it was just incredible to say, here was a seven-year-old who was ready to go. And when we talk about this diaper drive inside of this month, we begin with the first goal is diapers itself, 1,000 diapers. So if you have ever been one of those parents that in the middle of the night realized that you were short on diapers, you know just how critical this is and how amazing it is to be able to help. Stop and figure out. If you are the parent of a child who cannot change diapers often enough, that means that you keep a wet diaper on, and now it just magnifies itself with all the trouble that it makes inside of our families and community. We are very excited to be able to focus up. Is it a huge thing? Is it going to change the world? No. Is it a small thing that will change that family's world? Yes. And that's what we're after. So, there we go. As we enter into prayer, let's bow. Gracious God, we want to lift up all that's going on within our church and within our community. Lord, we give you thanks for the opportunities that we have to help others, to know that when we follow your word, that we are simply reaching out in love to others. And so, Lord, we ask your blessing on this diaper drive with all of the food and supplies and formula that are going to come in. We pray, Lord, that there would be a response within this congregation that loves the children inside our community. Lord, we lift up these families. We lift up the families who so desperately need these and ask that you would just help to get them over the hump, that you would get them not solving all their problems, but, Lord, helping them this week with their problems, helping them today with their problems. So, gracious God, we pray, as we watch mittens and undies and socks and hats go out into our community, so, Lord, now we watch as diapers go out and know that it is incredibly crucial. Lord, we pray for peace and know that sometimes peace begins with a diaper. Peace begins with clean socks. Peace begins in very small ways. Gracious God, we pray for peace within our world. Wherever there is violence over in Ukraine, in Gaza, in the Congo, wherever it may be, Lord, add the blessing that we might know your presence. In Christ's name we ask it, and it is in his name that we would pray together. Join me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Did you know that there are two creation stories in the beginning of the Bible? When Maggie read the first one, that's the newer of the two stories. And there was day one, and there was day two, and there was day three. But now, Maggie reads for us part of the older story, and this is the Adam and Eve version.
The second scripture reading is from Genesis book 3, verses 1 through 7. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired for making one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. Here ends the reading.
May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing, the understanding of this, God's Word. We are a people of the book, and a huge percentage of the people in this world are people of the book. The Jews are people of the book as they read through the Torah and the writings and the prophets in a collection that they call the Tanakh. The Muslims are a people of the book as they read through and make it as a part of their lives the Quran. We are a people of the book as we focus on the Old Testament and New Testament as we claim the Bible. I have an entire shelf of Bibles in my office. I love them, all these different translations and ways to understand. This is one of my most treasured Bibles. This it was the Bible that I received from my grandmother. I think it must have been about 2 years before she passed away, and she was trying to encourage me to go into ministry. She was one of the earliest ones who recognized, or at least hoped she recognized, the gifts for ministry in me. And so she said, would you ever like this? And I said, yeah, I'd love that. And so she signed it. What's most precious to me in here is her handwriting. That sixth grade handwriting that served her for all the rest of her life. But here's what's so funny about this book. It is in immaculate condition. I grew up with this book. My guess is that she probably got this in about 1947, and all the way through my childhood, this book sat in the same room, on the same coffee table, in the same position. It would get dusted, but it was never, ever used. Why? Because it was a symbol. When you came into my grandmother's house, this was her way of saying, you are in the house of people who follow Christ, and we believe in the Bible. Now, here's what I wish I could have also gotten that went with this. I wish that I could have had my grandmother's other Bible. You see, she had two. The one that she used always sat right there at the kitchen table. When she was in her chair, her Bible was constantly within use. That Bible fell apart. It was used for so many things. There were pressed flowers in between those pages. There were announcements of baptisms and announcements of birth and announcements of funerals. There were notes that were written. There were all kinds of things that were inside of that Bible. The binding on it had been destroyed years before I was born, and she kept that Bible together with a rubber band. Now that was a Bible. You see, we are a people of the book. And it is an amazing thing when we don't just say that about ourselves as a community, but we say that about us as individuals. Wouldn't it be an amazing thing for each of us to be able to claim, I'm a person of the book. Give me that one book. As we are about to launch into this year, I want you to realize that we live between two trees. In the book of Genesis, what you heard Maggie read today, in the Adam and Eve story, there was an Adam, and there was an Eve, and there was a garden, and in the garden there were plants and animals. There were all kinds of things that were happening. And one day the serpent came to Eve and said, "So, how do you like the garden?" And Eve said, "Love it. God walks with us all the time." And the serpent said, "Well, is there any place you're not supposed to go? Anything you're not supposed to do?" And Eve said, no, we can do anything. Oh, wait, there is that one tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the serpent said, "Really? And what are the restrictions there?" "Well, we're not supposed to eat anything." You know how the story ends. Absolutely, Eve not only took from that tree and ate, she gave it to Adam. What is the point of that story? The point of that story is that with that tree in the Garden of Eden, there were restrictions, there were rules that we were supposed to follow, and we didn't. And God stayed with us anyway. God was still present in the midst of all of that. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. All the way through the Bible, we go to the very last book. The 66th book is Revelation. And when you get into Revelation, what you discover is that there is another tree. In this garden where it was a newness of life, a new Jerusalem come down out of heaven, and in the midst of it was a garden, that it was a tree, and the tree was the tree of life. And what it says to us is, beginning with a tree in Genesis and ending with a tree in Revelation, that we are a people who live between the two trees. We are a people who live with the presence of God, even when things go wrong, even when things go right, no matter what, we are a people who live in the presence of God. This God, who was here long before our world was created, this God who will be here long after this world disappears, we are a people of God. Huh. Welcome to 2024. Every year we wish each other this new year, we wish ourselves blessings, we hope that there is so much good that is going to be coming inside of a new start. Well, a spoiler alert, 2024 is going to be a really rough ride. I mean, if you've been watching and listening, you know that the storm warnings are up for RSV and flu and COVID, but it's different than it was last year. It's going to be a rough ride for a lot of people just staying healthy. For instance, did you know that between a third and a half of all the people on the face of this planet are heading into elections this year? That's not going to be easy inside of this world. There's so many ways in which our lives are going to be so different. There's so many ways in which we're going to have to deal with difficulties and simultaneously with joys. We know that we're going to have to be dealing with all of this combined. Wouldn't it be an amazing thing to have some form of guidance that goes deeper inside of all of this? We look forward, we look for the ways of finding guidance. And so this is where we enter into the Bible year. One of the things that we're going to do is not just read the Bible all together as a congregation, we're going to teach you how to read the Bible. Let me give you an example. This is my very first Bible. I got it on my 7th birthday. My mom and dad gave it to me, and this was just the most amazing thing. It is red leather, and it has a zipper. I cannot tell you when I was a 7-year-old sitting in this pew. I was under the watchful eye of an entire congregation because they could see anything that we kids did. And I was also under the watchful eye of my father, the pastor. Let me tell you, hell hath no fury. Oh, I remember the day so incredibly well where my dad stopped preaching in the middle of the sermon came down, took me by the shoulders, and went, how do you make it through? How do you make it through worship? Well, here's one of the ways that you do it. Thank heavens for zippers. This zipper is worn out. I can't even make it close anymore. Because all through the sermon, I would be zipping and unzipping and zipping and unzipping. And that was what this Bible was all about. And then, lo and behold, I got to open it, and I discovered there were pictures. Now, mind you, if you're a 7-year-old trying to read this, an 8-year-old, a 9-year-old, a 10-year-old, no, it's just impossible. I had no idea where to start, no idea what half the words were. It was impossible. But I could read the pictures. And so my earliest theology began when I unzipped the Bible and started looking at pictures. And I could now begin telling you stories about when Jesus was 12 years old in the temple. I could tell you stories about when Jesus rode a donkey into Jerusalem. I could tell you stories about when the roof was ripped apart and a man was lowered down in front of Jesus. My earliest Bible reading was Bible pictures. And then, about the time I was 9 years old, my teacher said, "Scott, turn to John 3:16." She knew. I had no idea what John was. No clue how to find it. So she said, "Here's how you find it. We can mark John. Now you see the big numbers, look for a 3. Now you see the small numbers, look for 16. And John 3:16 became incredibly important to me. Say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe should not die but have eternal life. I see that your Bibles had zippers also." Yeah, this is how I began to learn the Bible. I had to have somebody over my shoulder pointing out to me, this is what this is. And then they said the words with me. I want you to think about this. When you just spoke those words, the young ones who are in our congregation, even they, though they may not know that verse yet, they were just surrounded by you speaking scripture to them. This is how we learn. And then I went into high school and I decided that I wanted to have a more active faith, and so I started reading more. And I got into my very first Bible study. It was on the book of Galatians. And then I went to college and I got into a New Testament class. Oh my gosh, and the world just opened. And it was not very long before I wore that Bible out. And it was after college that I got my next working Bible. And right now, it works out that about every 20 years, I wear my Bibles out. They are just beyond repair. And so I go and I get a new one. But I never get rid of the old one. They always sit side by side, because those are my working Bibles. This is what we're doing. We know full well that every single one of us is at a different place in how and where we read and understand Scripture. And that's fine. Wherever you are at, that's the perfect place to be. So now, how do we teach? And what you're going to see is that each week, when we go into the path, what you're going to see now is there is an introductory paragraph, but then there are Bible reading tips. How is it that we can give you tips for how to do this? So let me give you a few of those today. These books are now available. You may or may not wish to get one. But here's what happened. It's the Christmas season, and the delivery did not come when we wanted it to. The books were supposed to be here last week. Well, here they are. It's January 7th, and here is your new book. Congratulations, you are now 1 week behind. This is the thing that will kill your Bible reading, is we look at we just get overwhelmed by it to say, oh, are you kidding? An entire week behind, I can't even catch up as I begin. I give you permission to skip. I give you permission to skim. I give you permission to just stop at the headlines that you think are interesting. I give you permission to put a bookmark in your Bible so that you can just come back to that another time when you have the time. I give you permission to just skip ahead and start on today's reading. I give you permission to go find the Bible that you need. You know what my all-time pet peeve is? Oh, please forgive me for those of you who have these. Oh, the Precious Moments Bible. Oh, Stephanie, do you have one? Oh my gosh, they're just horrible. They're so beautiful. They're beautiful, beautiful Bibles, and they're white leather with the gold edging on the side, and the pictures are so cute. And it's written in King James English. Oh, good. Let's give a kid a Bible and make sure that they cannot read three words out of it. I give you permission to go find the Bible that works best for you. Are your eyes changing? I give you permission to go find yourself a large print Bible. Or take even a step beyond that. Why don't you just go find an audio Bible? Look online. I give you permission to go into the contemporary English versions. I give you permission to go, if you are one of those who loves the King James, oh my goodness, that English is so beautiful. I give you permission to go find the book that you need to do this. Here is a secret for you. I did not know this until I was a dad. Children's Bibles. Obviously, children's Bibles are going to skip a lot of stuff, and they're just packed with stories. But I could not believe some of the stories. When I started reading children's Bible to my daughters, there were stories in there I had never heard of before. And to this day, I love to learn by looking in the children's Bibles. What is it that you can do? I give you permission to go find a friend, or maybe it's your spouse, and you agree on a time. Maybe it's sitting down at breakfast and you read together out loud, or maybe you are just touching base. I give you permission to go find a friend and have a weekly coffee appointment together. I give you permission to do this long distance. Maybe you have a friend across the country. There are so many ways that we can do this, but I want to give you the permission that says, you don't just have to take the first Bible that you pick up, open it, start on page one. Because here's the deal. You're going to love Genesis. Oh my gosh, Genesis is just chock full of these great stories. The Tower of Babel and Noah's Ark. It's just incredible. And then you're going to get to Exodus, and you're going to read this high drama story about the Hebrew people being led by Moses out of the country and the establishment of the Jewish nation. It's amazing reading. And then you're going to turn the page and you're going to start reading Leviticus, and within 3.5 minutes, your eyes are going to glaze over. And oh my gosh. Now it turns out that Leviticus is a brilliant, amazing piece of work. But it was written in the original Hebrew 3,000 and 4,000 years ago. It is outdated, difficult language. Those are the moments. How many of us have said, I'm going to read the Bible, and we get to Leviticus, and that's it. The Bible goes back on the shelf. We're going to give you the hints how to get past that. How do we together do this? So every week when you come, what you're going to hear is there's going to be at least one reading out of the Bible year that you're going to hear reflected inside of the message and inside of worship. We give you permission to do it together. This is who we are. Why is this so important? Because we are a people of the book who live between the two trees. We have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in Genesis, and we have the tree of life in Revelation, and we live exactly between that. And life can be very messy. This is what we're doing, is together equipping each other to walk and to read and to understand more of what God is saying inside of our lives. I'm excited as the process begins, and I want to invite you in. Parents, your kids can participate in this too. You're going to have to be really, you're going to have to think about how to make it work, but there are ways that it can be done. It does not matter who you are, where you are, how old you are. It does not matter where you're at in life. This invitation is for all of us because we are a people of the book. May it be in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you pray with me? Lord of love and Lord of life, we want to give you thanks for your word, the word that changes us, the word that makes life so good. We ask that you would open up to us the possibilities of how we can read and how we can absorb and how we can understand. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We would celebrate communion together. It was on the night that he was betrayed that Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples. And as they were there, Jesus took the bread and lifting it, broke it, passed it among his disciples and said, "Now take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." And later, after the meal, Jesus took the cup and lifting the cup, blessed it, passed it among his disciples and said, "Now take and drink, all of you, for this is my blood, the blood of a new covenant that is poured out for the forgiveness of many." And so we come to eat and to drink and to remember that we are children of God. Would you bow with me? Gracious and heavenly God, we ask your blessing on these elements, that a small taste of bread in a small taste of the cup would be that huge love that you share with us, for us. Lord, we pray that this simple action would be one of the things that helps to change our lives. Help us to be better, stronger, bigger in you. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. I would ask those who are serving to come this morning. As they come, I would remind you that ours is a Wesleyan tradition. And what that means is that it does not matter who you are or who you are not, what church you go to or what church you do not go to. We share an open table. If you would like to share communion today, you are invited and welcomed. We make no difference for what the age of the kids are. Parents, we leave it to you to figure out how old a child should be in order to understand. This morning we will come down the middle. We'll start at the front, coming down the middle. As there will be two stations. There are baskets on either side to receive your cups. We invite you to stay and kneel in prayer as long or as short as you would like. The invitation is given. The table is set. Come.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. Here I live in hope. Your presence I've tasted and seen of the saddest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. Here I live in hope. presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Would you join me as we pray together? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I want to invite you to stand as together we sing and send each other on our way.
Whoa, 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 every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside, won't let you forget. And although my name is Deed, I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again, till you lost all belief. These are the voices, these are the lies, and I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved by the change, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. Whoa, 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 whoa. I am no longer defined by all the wreckage behind. It's all things new, has proven it's true. Take a look at my life. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called His children.
I am the Child of the One True King.
What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called His children. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I'm changed, and I've been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. Whoa, 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 whoa,
All right, my friends, receive this blessing. May you go as a people who have been named and have been claimed. Listen to that again. God knows your name because God gave you your name. God has claimed you. May you go in the name of God, who is your creator, Jesus Christ, who is your savior, the Holy Spirit, who is your guide. And as you go, may it always be in God's peace. Go.
Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
Have a great week, everyone.
Tickle him. Let's tickle him.